ladies and gentlemen, distinguished candidates. Welcome to the 2014 Candidate Forum, sponsored by Ocean Pines Association and the Elections Committee. I'm Bill Wentworth. I'm chair of the Elections Committee, and I will lead the forum. Please, as a courtesy for candidates and audience, silence your cell phones and kindly remain silent while the candidates answer questions. Now, well, with regard to that, a little decorum I always like to mention. We need a little decorum in these situations. The candidates may say some things that you agree with, may say some things you don't agree with. We would ask you to respect, you may not agree with what they say, but we would ask you and expect you to respect their right to say what they say. Okay, so just make the ground rules a little bit here. Please let us begin by everyone please stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This year, there are two positions opened on the Board of Directors. Here are our five candidates as they are seated before you, starting on your left and leading forward this way. Please stand, candidates, as I introduce you. Lawrence Lake, Pat Renault, Terry Moore, Jeff Knepper, Dave Stevens. And I would like to give a personal thanks. All these people take their time and their energy and their public service attitude to be involved in this process. The candidates participated in a blind draw on Friday, June 6th to determine their position on the ballot at today's forum. I would like to introduce to you at this time the election committee members. Cheryl Bissell in the back there. Laura Moon, right over here. John Topher, right over here. And Judy Butler, right here. Our timekeeper today is Tom Butler. We have solicited input from the membership this morning. Several of you filled out cards for questions you wanted to ask. We've also received several emails with questions that come from the community that want to be asked. And we will do that. We're going to make a real effort today to have the majority of the questions that are asked come from the community as opposed from the committee. We feel that it's more important for the committee, for the association members' questions to be answered than ours. There will be a few questions from the committee, but the majority of the questions come from those that have been put forth before us. The timekeeper will give you a sign when it's at the 30-second mark when your speaking time is complete. Each candidate may make an opening statement limited to 3 minutes. The second session will be three or more questions from the OPA Elections Committee. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to answer the same question. After that, a third session, special period, will begin where the candidates will ask one another a question. The cue for this process will be done by a draw. The candidate that asks the first question will then answer the second question. A number will be drawn to see which candidates, or not a number, a name will be drawn to decide which candidates will ask the second question and so on. Then we will have a fourth session where an opportunity for each candidate to offer a 90-second rebuttal to the answers given in the second, third session. 90 seconds for that. This session will be questions from the audience, and the candidates will have 2 minutes to address each of those. At the conclusion of the question and answer period, each candidate will have an opportunity for a 1 minute closing statement. The first question will begin with Lawrence Lake. The remaining candidates will then answer in order in which they are seated. Subsequent questions will be rotated in order in which the candidates are seated. Okay, starting with Larry, the first question.
Oh, how about the
opening statement? Oh, I'm sorry.
See, I was worried about me not remembering the rules. You know, I feel bad.
Here we go. Yes, James. Opening statement, Larry.
I have a short time to talk. It normally takes me this long to yawn. I mean, or at this early in the morning and everything. But basically, I'm your independent candidate running for a seat on the board of directors. I feel it's a challenge that must be met. I'm good at facing challenges. I've faced them all my life, and I've succeeded, braggingly saying, in most of them. The truth of the matter is that there's a lot that has to be done here. We have to get back to participative management or governing of this community. This is the key feature. My slogan, if there is a slogan, is progress through accountability. We've got to hold each member of the board responsible. We have to hold each person in the community responsible because you people are putting one of us in that seat. We're not members of the team, with the exception of one who has already said that she basically votes with regard to their wishes and everything. I'm not that type. I want it understood that, number one, the first challenge that we're going to face is this Yacht Club. Whether you like the Yacht Club or you're not happy with the Yacht Club, it's a challenge that we must take into hand. And the reason for that is that we cannot manage this. When you have a stock, you normally sell it as high as you can and get out. Right now, we have a stock that will look good in the next few months. What we must do is basically get a management company in here to successfully manage the Yacht Club and pay us rent and a percentage of the profits. It's not going to be an amenity that's going to be a big money maker for years and years and years. We spent a lot of money. A lot of money putting an entire front on that waterfront that we have. Stop and think, compared to what money was spent in that, how much money has been spent from the North Gate to the South Point with regard to the rest of this community? It's in need. Put your money where it should be spent. I will now thank you. Again, I remind you, my name is Lawrence Lee. Thank you.
Reminder, Kenneth, try to speak into the mic at a request of that. Make sure that everyone can hear. Okay. Next up.
Hi, I'm Pat Reneau, and my campaign theme is change, as you'll see on my brochure. If you can help, can you hear me? No?
Yeah.
I'll stand up. I don't know if the mic will work, but I'll try. Okay. And this is my campaign folder here. And when I did this campaign, I was reminded of about several years ago, about 30 years ago, when we moved from Maryland up to Pennsylvania when I was with Bethlehem Steel. And we told my son there was nothing more permanent than change. He was 15 years old, and he didn't believe it, not for a second. And he fought us and fought us and fought us. In fact, he played Cast Out with Cats over and over and over again, so it drove my wife nuts. But 4 years after that, he came to me and thanked me for the change, because it gave him impetus to go on to his career, which he is a movie director now, and he lives in Paris. So he's done very well. My wife and I, Jean, bought our lot here in 1992, and with contemplation that we're going to retire here. In 2000, we came down and we have planned design in our head, and we had hired a local contractor, and we built our home, and we've never been sorry. We've loved it here. We love all the amenities, even the ones I don't use. Even though I bought my golf hat for proof. My work experience includes human resources financial management. I worked private industry for 25 years with Bethlehem Steel and Rockwell International, and I worked for 21 more years in the state of Maryland, Baltimore County, and Board of Education, and Prince George's County. During that time, I was very active in healthcare coalition. For those of you who don't know what that is, that's a 501c3 trust, sort of like this. In fact, it's a volunteer organization. We have to follow the same kind of rules and regulations we follow here. I was chairman of that coalition for 4 years. In my opinion, the most important issue facing Ocean Pines today are the excessive capital expenditures and related operational losses of many of our important managers. Seeing the board and manager interact over the past few years makes me believe that there needs to be a better balance of power as well as clearly defined functions in each of those important parties. If elected, I'll do my best to see that we restore the needed balance to pursue our common goals and objectives. My promise to you is that I will work hard to resolve all the problems facing Ocean Pines Association and try to listen and take into consideration the various needs of our diverse community. In mid-July, you'll receive your ballots. Please take time to look carefully at the candidates. Remember, your vote is very important. I hope you'll give me your kind consideration.
Thank you very much for that. Terry?
Hi, I'm Terry Moore. I am finishing my term, my first term, on the board of directors. I'll answer the question that everybody's been asking first. I have been saying for probably over a year that I was not going to do this again. So everybody says, why did you change your mind? I changed my mind because I saw who was running, decided that I wasn't ready to give up on the diversity that hopefully I've brought to the board. I represent a different population of Ocean Pines, I think. I work full-time. I manage a large group. I have been a manager of all of my career, medical management, actually. And I represent the female population. I mean, that's pretty obvious. And I represent those people who may not be able to get to board meetings, who may not be able to participate, but want to do something for their community. So that's really why I did it. I'm not ready to lose what we've had. I was hoping that somebody else like me would come along and sign up, but it did not happen, and I couldn't let the opportunity pass. I am so proud of what we've done in the last 3 years. Yes, we have had some gaffes, geese to be specific, for one item, but other things. Has everything been smooth and rosy and great? No. But we have made some major progress in our community. I feel the difference. When I first moved here 7 years ago, I would read the local papers and I would just see such divisiveness, I don't even know how to explain it, but I didn't even want to read the papers. Hopefully, we've been able to turn that around a little bit. I think that we need to have a good relationship with our general manager. He is the manager of the operations of our association. I'd like to let him do that. We provide oversight. Members have issues. You come to us. That's what we're there for. If you just look at this last spring guide of all the things that Ocean Pines represents, this is you. This is what we've been able to do. And I would really like to continue. Thank you.
Thank you, Terry. Jeff?
Thank you all for coming this morning. Those of you who do not know me, I'm Jeff Pepper. Since I'm not that widely known, I thought there were some things you ought to know about. I've owned property in Ocean Pines since 2000 and lived here full-time, or less, since 2006. I've attended almost every board meeting since 2006, either by internet or in person. My education consists of a Bachelor of Science in Business Administration and a law degree. My dad was a small business owner and mom was an artist and stay-at-home mom. I learned business principles from him and the values of honesty, hard work, and empathy, both of them. I learned teamwork crewing on one design sailboats racing in the state of Ohio, New York, and Tennessee. I have managed groups from 6 to about 450, all with excellent results, high morale, very low turnover. I am considered an expert in business use of technology. I'm well organized and have brought some of that organization to OPA. I'm an independent, which means I care about issues. I don't care about whether I'm in minority, majority, whatever. Anyone can keep score. I have no agenda other than to support Ocean Pines and do what we all need to have done. And I'm not a particularly good politician. I've never learned that skill. My demeanor is low-key, and I tend not to get excited about much of it. That can be helpful at times. I like the process that I use is I collect input. That can be data, that can be opinions, that can be whatever it is. I analyze it. I understand it to the best that I can. I discuss it with whoever's appropriate, and then I decide or act whatever's appropriate thing. The board will consider a number of issues this year, golf course operation, technology refresh. Yacht club operations are the top three for me. Drainage, we're at sea level, it's a problem. Country club, and we figure out golf club. I look at amenities in total, and the net is what's important to me. If you want to work on one or two, then the individual performance is fine, but the net is what I do. And the target of that should be breaking. I'm a member of the only board that has ever lowered the assessment. And I led the effort to do that. Finally, I've already changed the direction of our technology refresh by recasting the RFP that was going to be issued. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. Dave?
My name is Dave Stevens. That's a little too close, I think. I believe my bio information is briefly described in the handouts that are at the door, so I'm going to pass over that. If you don't know me at all, what is relevant in that is that from 2007 through last year, I served on the board. I was elected twice, and I had to sit out for term because of term limits the last year. I can honestly say that I did not expect to be sitting here today. But over the past year, past 4 years, I've had the strong belief that something is going very wrong with the governance of this community. I decided that I had to step in and see if I could do something about it. Now, it's fair to ask, what could be so wrong? Well, we have a beautiful new yacht club, a new yacht club pool, revitalized golf course, and thank you, $5 decrease in the annual assessments. Well, maybe there isn't anything wrong unless you wonder at what cost. That's the rub. Ask yourself these questions. Are we building for the future what OPM members really need, or what meets the general manager's private vision of what is needed? Are requirements developed based on actual financial history of a amenities use, or the speculation that increased revenues from outside sources will somehow make our operational losses disappear? Has the general manager provided the board with any real business data or analyses to demonstrate that the golf club is financially profitable and sustainable on its own from any approach? Over 4 years, did the board ever receive an actual business plan for any of its operations? Did it receive any analysis on the return of the $100,000 investment that we made in the Java Cafe? The issues in this election are straightforward. There are two incumbent candidates, and if either is elected, nothing will change. The board majority remains the same, not because they lack the capability, but because they don't see it any problem. If you do see the need for a change, then please vote for Pat Renaud and myself. It is the one way that you can make a difference.
Thank you. We will now move into our second session, where we will begin with asking the candidates questions that the committee has generated. And we will start answering the questions, starting with Larry. Work this forward. The first question is: What do you see as your primary role as an elected director of Ocean Pines?
To represent the people of Ocean Pines. To get back to the heart of Ocean Pines. To listen to the pulse of Ocean Pines. And to make decisions that can benefit this community today and into the future. And ladies and gentlemen, you do that with one word. It's not rocket science. That word is accountability. Everyone must be held accountable, from the board of directors all the way through the general manager. The general manager actually works for the board. It's got to be kept that way.
Pat,
yeah.
And you've got 2 minutes to answer.
Thank you. I agree in part, and certainly with what Larry is saying. I think the problem that I see today is sort of what David sees also, is the governance. We need to get back to the point where the board is in charge of what it's in charge of, and the general manager is in charge of what he's in charge of. And we should not micromanage at all, but we should be holding ourselves responsible. The board needs to have information from the general manager prior to the meeting. I have not seen it. Meetings I've gone to, I have not seen agenda where they're receiving it 3 to 5 days in advance. When I was the chairman of the board, that was a requirement. The person was the executive director. I don't see that. I think that needs to be done, and that needs to be done now. Thank you.
Just add to what Pat just said, being the secretary this year up until my re-election bid, our agendas are published at least 3 to 5 days ahead of time. We are provided with packets 3 to 5 days ahead of time. Sometimes we'll have a piece missing if we're still, but that information is available to us. I see one of our biggest challenges as what Jeff alluded to, our information technology system. We have grown and grown and grown, and unfortunately our computer system has not. So all these great things like card swipes that we do to get into the pool or whatever, it's a big issue. We need to really, really look at that. And Jeff is an expert, so it's great that he's running again. We take our issues as they come. I personally look to the general manager to provide with me what is needed in the community. He is the one who runs the community. When he comes to us and says, we have this, this, and this, we try to prioritize. That seems to be what we've done in the 3 years that I've been on the board. And we just kind of chip away at things. A good example, again, is this computer problem. We started with talking about it. We started having work sessions this year, 2 weeks prior to the meetings, so that we could have a discussion before we actually came to the board meeting. So we had 2 weeks in between to gather more information, research, whatever. So I think one of our biggest challenges, to be specific, is our information technology systems. But I think that our challenges are whatever present to us as they come along.
Thank you.
Yes.
The biggest challenge is often figuring out what it is we want. We're very diverse, very large, and you can find opinion all over the place on any topic. And what is really, really important to someone is of no interest to the next person. So a big challenge is trying to figure that out, and we need to do a better job. The projects that I listed in my opening remarks are, it's not rocket science to figure out what the list is. It's going to be hard to solve some of those. Golf has been a nagging problem for years. We have to figure that out. Information technology, I won't go into it here, but the systems here are not very good, and that's charitable. We've got to do something about that. It's going to be complicated. It's going to be expensive. But it's got to be done, and it's got to be managed. So we have to do that. We've just built a $5 million yacht club. Now we've got to run it. And that's going to be a challenge, learning how to do that, fine-tuning it, getting it right. We've spent the money. We can debate it if we want to, but the money spent building there. Let's run it right. Let's figure out that. And there's some other issues that we have to do, and we have to get better at work. Yes.
Thank you, Jeff.
Dave?
Could you repeat the question, please? It's tough being here.
We certainly can. What do you see as your primary role as an elected director of Ocean Pines?
Okay. My primary role as an elected director of Ocean Pines isn't necessarily to point out the challenges. I think most people know what they are. I think the important thing, this is an important question, is who has responsibility and which responsibility for which actions. If you go to your bylaws, it spells out very clearly what the roles, the responsibilities are, actually its powers and duties, as Jim Trumbull's back there. That says what the powers and duties of the board are. They also say what the powers or the responsibilities of the general manager are. It's in terms of defining policy, in terms of defining what requirements are, we're going forward in Ocean Pines. That is a responsibility. And it's not something that can be thrown over the fence to the general manager and say, you know, general manager, come back and tell us what you think about this or do this when you have the time to do it. And that's probably one of the biggest objections I've had, what has happened over the last 4 years, is that the can keeps getting kicked down the road on one project after another. And we're not so much projects, but one planning activity after another. Where are the requirements? As I said in my opening remarks, are we building a future towards what a few individuals think, or do we actually have a requirements process where we go through it and the board ultimately decides that this is a requirement and we will fund it and we will go forward? After, of course, public meetings and so on. That's where we've gone wrong, and I think it's the board's responsibility. It has to take back that responsibility that the bylaws give it.
Thank you, Dave. Thank you, Dave. The next question, we will start with Pat answering first, and the question is, Ocean Pines Association, OPA, is a corporation. What do you think is the main function of the OPA?
Thank you. I think the main function of the OPA is pretty much what Dave has said. The OPA is supposed to maintain policy. You know, you took your old courses that I took years ago in policies and procedures. The general manager carries out the procedures. The OPA is the one who makes the policy. So that's what we're supposed to be doing. We're supposed to be making the policy. We need input from the general manager, and I think he's given some good input, certainly. I don't deny that. But I think the ultimate decision has to be with the OPA itself as far as policy is concerned. Thank you.
The OPA is the Ocean Pines Association as a whole, not just the Board of Directors. The Board of Directors is just a functioning part of it. The association and all of its members look to the board to provide guidance, set policy, keep the ship running where it's supposed to go. And again, I'll repeat, I think that we have to do that with our general manager, not as opposed to our general manager. He is the one, and the staff and the directors and the members who use our facility and live here, you guys are the ones that tell us what needs to be done in Ocean Pines. OPA is all of us.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. OPA's main function is to operate the association for the benefit of the members, providing services that they want and are willing to pay for. It has a board of directors that operates the corporation, and it has a general manager and staff that provides the day-to-day operations. So we have to figure out what it is we want, what are we willing to pay for, and then get it done.
Yeah, Dave?
The OPA, to start out with, I agree with Terry, actually. I mean, it's a lot of things. It covers all of us. But first and foremost, it's a corporation. It has declarations of restrictions. It has articles of incorporation. It has bylaws. And it has board-generated resolutions. The community operates and is governed by electing a board of directors. They're the ones that get the vote. They're the ones that have to make the decisions and have that responsibility. Board of Directors has help to advisory committees. And these advisory committees are basically the board's window into the community. It's how we get input, the formal way we get input from the community. Now, there's lots of other ways. All you have to do is, you know, walk through the aisle if you're a director. And you'll get a lot of input, generally, from a lot of different people. But basically, the thing that I want to point out is, while Terry's right, it is everybody. The structure is what's important. That's what makes it a corporation. Those governing documents.
Thank you.
Whoa.
Oh, I'm sorry. I forgot you. I'm sorry, Larry.
I can't help but thank because I've been missed a couple times already. My God, how can you miss me? The question came, you know, and I have to stop. It's all, okay? And the people decide to govern in their best interest. It's that simple. But the people, persons in Ocean Pines, are the ones that have to hold the accountability factor high. Represent you. Represent what you want. We want to basically do a good job. It requires your input. As Terry said, Dave, the rest, it's all of us, okay? And it's also the management or governing of the policies with regard to those kinds of the way it's been set up. Thank you.
Thank you. The third question from the committee is, what is your preferred approach to funding a project, a reserve system, a special charge, or a loan? Please explain.
Guessing that's me.
Yes, that is you.
I think it really depends on the project. I know that in the projects we've done in the past, the funding of the project is always a long discussion. Depends on the size and the scope of the project. Something as large as the yacht club, we had to come up with a reserve mechanism. We had to come up with a lot of mechanisms. Something like our roads project that the state has, or the county has, withdrawn its funding of that process. Funding mechanism became the casino funds. We had that casino money and trying to figure out what to do with it, and thought that money could really be well spent on our roads. I couldn't really answer that question, what is the best way to fund the project, unless I knew the scope of the project. That would
Thank you. Jeff?
It's really all three. There are three different funding mechanisms. They have different ramifications. If you look at reserves versus a loan, that changes who actually pays for the amenity or whatever you're talking about. So sometimes reserves are the right way to go for things that you know are coming, that you know approximately when they're coming, and set money aside, and so forth. Loans, depends on what the market rate of interest is. You have to understand you'll shift pays to someone else because the people who pay are the ones who pay back the loan later. And you have to think about assessments. You can pay these things with special assessments. Those are always fun. They rarely work. But you could, you know, that is a method some people like to use. I don't favor that at all. I personally like reserve system with a loan as appropriate. But you, associations do it all three ways and are, I guess, successful. So I like the first two. I don't like there.
Thank you, Dave.
I guess the real question is, of course it depends on the individual project, but it also depends on how the project comes up. If you have a reserve system, if you have a actually had a capital improvement plan, which looked at the funding stream as you looked at future projects, then that question wouldn't really have to be asked. It would have been asked up front before the project ever got there. The problem is that over the last 4 years, there have been many out-of-budget requests that have, out-of-budget means, by the way, we start at the beginning of the year, and then sometime in the middle of the year, somebody comes in and says, "We need to, our general manager, general, is going to, we need to do this." Now, there's two reasons that can happen. One is, this is the latest, greatest idea. So, an example would be the Java Cafe. Another one is a little bit more troublesome in that it generally can be ascribed to a lack of made proper maintenance, or the lack, and that sounds like too long a term, but in other words, somebody didn't do something that they had been supposed to be doing, and the facility failed. And we have many examples of that. We have the Yacht Club Pool as an example, and we have the Golf Course Green as an example. Those things are not easily avoidable, but they are avoidable. And again, it depends upon your degree of planning that you put into it, the real work into it
again. Thank you. Larry?
Depends on the issue. Whether it's a loan that we need, whether it's assessments, the issue dictates how the money is funded, okay, or how the project is funded. But let me just add a little point here. Recently, Ocean Pines has run the concept, in my opinion, that if we make it bigger, they will come. Quite frankly, I don't believe many of you people are interested in the public. I think you're more interested in community. Okay? As a matter of fact, business and government, we look back on big. In the last 50 years, how many additional bureaucracies in our federal government have been added, which adds the word big government? How many businesses fail very simply because they expanded too much? They spent too much money and had to fold. Whether it be small businesses or restaurants or anything like this. As a matter of fact, the only person that I know who basically used the concept, build it bigger and they will come, was inspired by a mouse. His name was Walt Disney. Let me warn you, Ocean Pines is not Disneyland on the asshole.
Thank you. Pat?
Yes. I like all of the comments. Everybody has something good to say. Everybody has an issue. only issue, I guess, if there is one, is that we need to confine what we have in the project as to what kind of money we have to spend. My wife will tell you that she is the toughest budgeter that I know of. And when something goes out of budget, we don't get it. And I think that's the problem I see at times, that we do go out of the budget, and next thing you know, we're having an operating fund loss, or we have had for the last 3 years. And I think those are the kinds of problems that we have to be careful. We have to look at each project, as Jeff said, and Gary said, and Dave said, and Larry said, and look at what the value of it is, how much does it cost, and whether we can afford it. If we can't afford it, then we have to find a way to get it. Thank you.
Thank you. Now we will go into our next session, whereby the candidates will have an opportunity to ask each other questions. And I always bring a prop from time to time. It's a little sand bucket. This, the idea of this is representative. For one, play nice, Sam. Now, what I have here is in the magic envelope here, I have each of our candidates' name. And what I'm going to have the candidates do is start the first one, walk down here, and have them draw a name. The name that Larry draws will be the kind that he asks the question of. And after that's concluded, whoever he's asked, let's say he's asking me a question. When I'm done answering, when I'm done finished answering that question, I will draw a name. That's the person I'll ask.
Did we get a chance to bump
hands? Okay. Yeah. There's a revolver. There's a revolver. Okay.
I thought I remembered hearing.
In Dutch, they're all the same people. You're concerned about that.
My goodness. This is my favorite candidate.
Draw your name?
Yes.
I think you should ask yourself a question. And make sure it's a tough one.
You missed that opportunity.
No, I was telling myself. You know, I bet that's going to happen. I swear.
Pat, unfortunately, you drew... The first question.
Okay.
And realizing that you want to fully devote your time and effort for the next 3 years to this task and the challenges that it faces, the question that I might ask, I had questions for everybody else. The question that I would ask is, why are you aligned with anybody if you're an independent thinker and can handle and make decisions by yourself without being influenced by someone else?
That's a very good question. The reason is because if you watch the board sessions at this time, the split always goes 5-2. It's the same 5 and the same 2, just about. So in order to change that paradigm, in order to have a change in the board, a change in direction, we need to have two candidates come in that are not aligned on the board, Dave Stevens and myself, and Larry too. Larry could be. We don't agree with each other on every issue, but we do agree on the issue of governance. We think it should come back to the board. We should be in charge. That's the reason why. Hey, my question is to Jeff Nepper. Jeff, I know in the past time that we had this situation with general manager salary, my understanding is that you authored that declaration or contract with him, and I would like to know where that research came from that we were paying such a high salary for this association.
Okay, fair question. The problem is that the answer to that question takes about 15 minutes. The research was substantial. It was extensive for an organization of size. There's a 4-page memo that documents it. willing to do for anyone that's interested. I will stay after the meeting, and we can talk about this as much as you want. But I can't do it in 2 minutes.
No, whoever you
ask.
Oh,
that's right.
I know. I'm having trouble following the instructions myself.
Terry Moore.
One of the main issues, in fact, what I think is close to the number one issue in this place is golf. And what do we do with it? You know, there sits the course. So if you could share with me what your philosophy is with respect to that amenity and where you see us going with it, understanding that this is the future and you don't know. What do you think?
When I was elected to the board, I think golf was probably the hottest topic, and I didn't know anything about our golf course. I learned very quickly a lot about our golf course, including what the dirt is made out of. We made the decision early on, through a lot of discussion, a lot of research. Really, Bob was bringing dirt, sod into the golf course to see. We had experts. And we realized that our golf course was in really bad condition. I will tell you, the decision to spend the money to replace those greens at times was very agonizing. But I knew that that was a really important amenity, not just to the people who play golf, because I don't play golf, but to our community and our home values. And I thought that we needed to invest what needed to be done to bring that golf course back up to the standard it should be. We made that decision. It took us 2 years to do it. We split the greens work in 2 years, so therefore we lost a lot of golf play and a lot of money in 2 years. Casper Golf runs our golf course. I haven't been pleased with how they've been running the golf course. Contrary to a lot of things that are being said, we don't always vote for time to, and there's usually a lot of discussion that happens. I was one of the people this year that said, leave the golf course alone for this season. Let the golfers go out there and enjoy that course. Let Casper prove to us whether they can make it work or not. And come October, November, then we need to make a decision and decide whether to lease, whether to sell, whether to whatever, whether to get a park. So that's where I stand on golf operations.
What why are they signed to run? It was, I don't want to say it's a last minute decision. That would imply that I haven't thought of that decision. This point of support. Because I truly, honestly believe that we've gone in the wrong direction. It's not an overwhelming, but I think the board has relinquished a lot of its honest responsibilities and passed them to the. I am a competent general manager. He's competent in very many things, but not in everything. And he is not a person who is responsible for developing the requirements for the association, for the Tunnels Association. That change has to be made. And having served with you 2 years on the board, Jerry, 4 years for me before that, I know very well that, in fact, you can only achieve this if you have a majority vote, people are generally thinking the same thing. You think Marty Clark and I agree all the time? I mean, nobody could agree with Marty Clark all the time. But that's the thing. It's just not going to happen. But he probably listened some sooner. So at any rate, that was the reason for my decision, because I think that had a hand, and I didn't see any other way or any other candidate to make.
Dave, your question is to Larry. Yeah. The last one.
This is serious. Larry, I know almost certainly of all of the candidates. I know the least about you. I mean, we probably talked 2 times, and I read the papers, okay? And so that's the sum total, and I was listening to what you were saying today. And I believe you said something in your opening remarks about, you know, we should put our money where it should be spent. And I think you were referring to not in very high-priced facilities, but in important infrastructure, such as bridges, roads. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong. But my question, though, is where and who, how do we decide where to put our money? What is the process for doing that? And who does and who should be making that decision?
Thank you, Dave. Infrastructure. Quite frankly, that's where our money should be going. To keep Ocean Pines the fine community that it's evolved into. Ocean Pines is a group of eclectic homes built over 47 years that basically blend beautifully together in a lovely setting. Right on the place. We have golf for the golfers, and I miss golf tremendously, but I used to love playing it down here at Ocean Pines. We have the waterways, boaters, the marina, everything like that. When we talk about infrastructure, the first thing we must do there is identify it. Where is the problem? And we list it accordingly by prioritizing. Identify, prioritize, and then resolve the problem as promptly as possible. That's governing. That's taking care of the community. That's building the community. That's making it what it is from the North Gate all the way to the south portion of this property. Their roads, their trees that have to be trimmed. Ocean Parkway is a disgrace. A lot of your neighbors won't go driving at night because of its winding roads. We should be looking at things like this. Instead, we're spending, in my opinion, and I'd love to see it audited, all the money on the waterfront. Thank you.
Thank you, candidates. We will now move into our next session, where each candidate will have an opportunity to give a rebuttal. We answer in 90 seconds to give a rebuttal to any question or statements that have been made. We'll start this round with Jeff Knepper.
I'd
thought the answers to the questions were pretty reasonable. I don't have any. Dave?
I'm not so sure you could call this a rebuttal, but since I asked Larry the question, I'll perhaps add something to what he said. He said identify and prioritize, and certainly that's true. The real issue comes in exactly by what criteria do you prioritize. But there's also a missing element there, too. And this is something that I think perhaps more than anything is hurting to watch over the last 4 years. That's to ask, what is the requirement? What do we really actually need in ocean ponds? And this is a hard question to answer. If you look at the Yacht Club, I spent many months going through working on the 10-year planning task force, and I was on it when I was not, it originated when I was president, and it went through a lot of iterations, a lot of back and forth, a lot of hard work, all of that visible to the public. And the hardest thing was to say, what do we really need? So you look at the Yacht Club, and that wasn't the conclusion, by the way, of what we have now was not the conclusion of that task force. That came in later, and it came in from a group that met quietly by themselves, reporting only to the general manager. Because you needed that paper. Actually, I think the answer is probably not.
Okay. Larry?
This is not so much about when you were around, Dave. When a general manager was picked, when you were on board, and I believe you were the president, why weren't present board members goose from running for the position of general manager?
Is that a question? I mean, for information, I'd be happy to answer it. I think, you know, historically, of course, it was closed session, and the general manager was not recused. It's very simple.
No.
I can answer that question for anybody who'd like to ask me after the meeting, after the session. No, thank you. You're right.
Actually, I have no rebuttal. I think what I said, I stand by. I think Dave and Mike, if we're elected, we can come in. We can make some of the changes that are necessary. Somebody asked me whether I really don't like Bob Thompson. The answer is absolutely not. I like Bob Thompson. Great guy. But I think he needs some help. And some help may be some professional management with a golfing situation, or maybe the same thing with the Yacht Club. It's difficult to be a general manager of all those amenities and run well and be in charge of them and have the responsibility to do it. I think he needs some help, and I think he's fine.
You all pull your microphones a little closer.
Oh. Did everybody hear what I said or no?
No, we didn't hear.
No, okay, sorry. I'll go back. What I said was that...
Sorry.
There.
Okay, can I have...
No.
Oh, your microphone closer. Okay. I can't give up this opportunity to not rebut a few of the things that Dave said. And just so you know, our comprehensive plan group, we just elected a new chair at our last meeting. Those of you who were there, listen online. Dennis Hudson is our new chair, so we are moving forward with our comprehensive plan. The Java Bay Cafe keeps coming up, and everybody has their opinion about it. Actually, I enjoyed the place. It was nice to go sit, read the paper, have a cup of coffee, meet people there. But I really think it might be time to let it go. Let's put that one to rest. Dave keeps saying that we're going in the wrong direction. The only thing that I will advise people is if you think we're going in the wrong direction, please email us, come to the meetings. There's always a public session at our meeting. Stand up and tell us
what direction we're going wrong in. You don't know if you don't tell us. And lastly, just so you know, a good example of the open to the public concept that we have really been pushing for people to come to our yacht club and utilize our golf course and whatever. A really good example of what just happened was the talk about the boat ramps. We heard loud and clear from you all that you don't want our boat ramps open to the public. We are looking into that. We're trying to decide how to do it, how to secure it, et cetera, et cetera. So that's how you get to us. Tell us.
Thank you. We now move into our fifth session where we will ascertain questions that came from membership. And you will have 2 minutes asked to answer each question that is posed. And I will be starting that session with...
responsibility of the board, and they should be the one that's taking the lead in it.
Eric?
Could you say the question again?
Sure can. What is your view of the board's role in managing capital spending?
Just as everyone else said, our role is to approve capital expenditure. You don't see a lot of what goes on behind the scenes. I know in my case, when we have a large capital expenditure, even a small, I research it. I don't vote for anything that I haven't looked into appropriately. But, you know, our role is to represent what all of OPA needs in capital expenditures, not what the board thinks, not what Bob Thompson thinks, not what just the members think. We have to take into consideration how it affects all of us. I don't make those decisions lightly, and if I disagree, I disagree. So I think we have to consider everybody's input and vote accordingly.
Thank you. Jeff?
I agree with much of what has been said. The board's role starts with understanding requirements. Okay, you can't make anything unless you kind of know what you're going to make. So you have to go look at what's needed, what's wanted, how much does it cost, because if it's a $5 billion asset, probably not going to build it here. So you have to start with requirements, and from that you can develop a list of the assets it takes to handle those requirements and when they need to come online, and in detail now how much they're really going to cost as opposed to the estimate was used before. And that work needs to be driven, in my opinion, by the board through the committee structure and with the aid of general manager and staff. And with the substantial aid from you all, you have to tell me at some level through some mechanism what you want. What do you want to do? You want a Ferris wheel? Okay, let's talk about a Ferris wheel. Whatever you want, let's get that up. Let's talk about it. Let's figure out what it'll cost. If it's going to benefit three people, you get a different answer than if it's going to benefit 5,000. So you have to go through that whole process. And unfortunately, you're talking about things that in many cases are 10, 15, 20 years out. I don't know about you, my crystal ball's broken. So I don't actually know what's going to happen there. I can take some guesses. I can ask you what you would like. I can talk to the community around us because they're important too. And out of that, we develop a process and go try to fulfill that plan, keeping it up to date as we go.
Thank you. We move on to our second question from the community, and we'll start that. Larry, what is your position on the golf course? Want to see it turned into a park?
The answer to that is no. And this is the reason.
Oh, it's Mike.
I'm sorry.
Bring it to me.
My Lord, I don't think my voice needed it, but here goes. My vote is to keep the golf course. A lot of the changes in that golf course occurred during the playing season. We lost valuable time. When golfers start playing somewhere else, they start enjoying that golf course more. Okay? The golf course is important to Ocean Pines, just like the waterways, the canals, the river, and the bay are. Okay? We have our boaters. The core of Ocean Pines is the golf course as well as the waterways here. Let's face it, a lot is being said about golf, and I just wonder, we go into a park, then all of a sudden it's too costly to maintain the park. And what do we do with the land? Well, gosh, we could develop that land. Some of the people may have some vested interest in closing that golf course. Long range. I think you've got to be smart enough to start thinking that way as well. The golf course has to be changed so that people here
on the plate of those keys now. I think a novel approach would be to basically redo the golf course and to basically have another set of keys for the older people in the community to enjoy. And thank you.
Thank you. Pat?
I brought my golf hat to prove to you all that I am in favor of keeping the golf course. I've heard rumors that said I do. I want it. And only as a last resort would it not happen. But believe me, I really want to keep it. And what I think needs to be done is that we need to have a professional manager in here that has a vested interest, that has can lose, win or lose based upon leasing the golf course. I've always been believed in the profit motive. I came from the private sector, and I think it makes a difference to have somebody have, as Martin liked to say, a skin in the game. And I think that's exactly what we need to have. If you look at the golf history over the last 7 years, in 2007, 70%, we had 802 golfing memberships, and they played 70% of the golfing time on the course. As of now, we have 236 golfing members using only 40% of the course. This is given to me by Bob Kessler. This needs to change. We need to bring it back. If you look at all the other golf courses around, yeah, we've got 16, 17, 18 of them. I also looked into the golf packages as how they rate the golf courses. Unfortunately, we rate next to last of out of 17 golf courses for golf packages. I don't accept that. I don't like that. And we have a wonderful golf course. Robert Trent Jones would be rolling over in his grave if he saw what we were doing. We need to bring it back. And we can bring it back. We can bring back the membership. We can bring back these things if we get a professional manager to come in and manage it. Thank you. That's all I have to say.
Thank you. Derek?
I just have to say that Pat's hat is from Lighthouse Sound.
You're really on your game
today. I see. I laughed when I heard the question because I'm almost certain it came from somebody in the environmental. Because when I was in my first year on the board, I was the liaison to the environmental committee, and I'm telling you, I heard that every week because that's when we were doing the Greensburg. We should just turn it into a park. And I really don't know at this point what the future of our golf course is. I think that's up to all of us. I want to get through this season, and then I really want to take a good hard look at maybe it should be a park. Maybe it should be a world-class Robert Trent Jones golf course. Maybe it should be a putt-putt course. Maybe it should be housing. Maybe it should be something else. I don't know, and I'm not even going to think about it, what the future holds for that golf course, so we see what we can do this season, let people enjoy that course that we worked so hard on, and then we'll start that fresh in the fall.
Yep.
I second your comments, Terry. The golf course is a complex question. I don't play golf, by the way. I like the golf course. I'm glad it's here. I do know that the losses that have occurred in recent years are not sustainable. We probably have the money to cover them. It's not the right thing to do to have golf at that level. Whether it can be profitable or not, I don't know. Others are. This one isn't. Maybe it could run at a small loss. Remember, I said earlier that I like to look at amenities net. So if the golf course was a loss and there were a small loss and there were profits and other amenities, maybe the net would be fine. Changing it into a park is an interesting idea, not that easy to do. And by the way, you will be stunned at what it costs to keep the park up. And there's no revenue, none. So it's a park, it's open, and the amount of money that then would be a dead loss shocked me. I thought it was going to get to mow the grass. How expensive can it be? Well, a lot of grass. Anyway, it's something that needs to be considered. Last on my list is something like a park. I don't think it's the right thing. We need a good operator. Casper had a great reputation. Hasn't worked out for us. Don't know why. Not sure I care why. But I think we need to figure that out, figure out what level of financial performance out screaming about how bad golf is. Let's go fix it then, according to plan. And if that means it stays, great.
Thank you. Dave?
Let's see now. I just wrote out a check at the beginning of this year for my 35th year of membership in the Ocean Pines Golf Course. And so, yeah, turn it into a portfolio. This is a sort of an aside. I don't want to get into this, but there actually already has been, and this a presentation on an idea to basically turn the tenfold the golf course into a box. It didn't go anywhere, so that's a good thing. Terry, you said that, you know, and I heard Tom Terry, the other Tom Terry or the other Terry, say that, you know, we're going to hold, you know, Casper's feet to the fire, something like that. Basically, you're going to wait to see. They've got a pristine course right now. I mean, at this point, I agree with that. And see what they can do with it. Well, my objection to that, I'm not sure it's an objection, but my point is, so when you get there, what are you going to do? I mean, suppose it doesn't work out. You're going to wait until that point to come up with a solution. And you know, I know Pat said leasing, but I've been involved for a lot of the years, not just with the golf course, but with food and beverage, in looking at different leasing arrangements we've had in the Ocean Pines. And it's difficult problem. Oh, good. I have one last thing that I want to say. One of the things that I've done when I was the last 3 years on the board, since we had Billy Casper, if you look at Billy Casper's contract, they are supposed to report to the board, and they're supposed to do it on a regular basis. I have asked the general manager, I have asked the, let's say, board majority, to give us that opportunity to talk to Billy Casper and find out. That has been denied consistently, and that's what we have to do in person. That's what we will do if I'm elected.
Thank you. Okay, the next question, we'll start with Pat, and that question is, do you view amenities, including sports, as separate businesses that must each make a profit, or do you see these as assets to the community that adds its attractiveness and value?
Well, I think they are definitely assets to add to the community, and I bring up Jeff here, and his situation is that if you put them all together together, and you have a loss in golf, but you have a gain in tennis, that might be acceptable. However, we don't seem to have that. We have a lot of losses and a lot of different things. My biggest amenity is swimming. Somebody said, well, Pat, would you be willing to pay more for swimming? My answer is yes. But I think that the point is that we need to look at each amenity as separately. However, we can combine them together as far as finding a strategy to try to make all either be profitable or be close to being profitable. I don't think we've really done that. We're looking at the amenities as each separate entities. Somebody mentioned to me when I was in a swimming situation, he said, why don't we combine the beach club and the swimming together since they both deal with water? I said, well, that's a good idea because then we'd be profitable for swimming if you look at the numbers. But, so we can look at it many different ways, but I think we need to try to find a way to make each amenity profitable, and we need to find a way to combine those things so that we don't overload one against the other. Thank you.
Our amenities are not necessarily supposed to be profitable. Our amenities are our amenities because they're here for us. We do have some of the things that we provide that are profitable. We do have some of those things that cost us money, but that's what we signed on for when we moved to Ocean Pines. We have a golf course that we want to participate. We have 5 pools if we want to participate. We're not forced to buy memberships in any of these activities if we don't want to. But we also have learned and have opened Ocean Pines up to our greater community. As I pointed to, we have so many programs available now, and they do, some of them do, cover costs or make profits. And we're looking closely, and our our department directors. Sonia Bounds is a great example. When she looks at a program, she's not just looking, she's looking at how much is it going to cost us to do? Can we make a little bit of money? This guide is a good example. Advertising is now sold to pay for this guide, to pay for a lot of the things that we do. We didn't do that before. So we have a lot to offer. Our amenities are here for us. We're not forced to use them. We're not forced to buy memberships. I don't have to get a golf membership if I don't want to play golf. But we do have them open to the public as well so that maybe we can offset the cost.
Yeah. My answer is that we look at amenities in two different ways depending on what we do. We have a list and they apply and are available to everyone under the terms. It's one of the reasons why I look at that. If you want to figure out what to go work on, okay, you'd like to make your net better, for example, you would pick the ones that were losing money. You'd probably pick the biggest loser, go work on that, assume you could make some traction with that and make it better, then you'd pick the next loser. You wouldn't make your most profitable, you wouldn't waste time with your most profitable amenity, you know, necessarily trying to make it better. You could, but I would go for the losers. That's when you look at them individual. When you're thinking about them overall, they apply to all of us. They're amenities for all of us. All amenities available. I don't want to separate them out then. I want to look at the net. And yes, that lends one fun part of the other. And those could change over time. And that's fine.
Thank you. Dave?
Yeah, there's an answer to this question. And if anybody wants to go to the webpage, our webpage, look up Doc. Under resolutions, that would be MO2, and it's an amenities resolution. And I spent a lot of hours, and along with the other board members at the time, trying to wrestle with this. I think it pretty much spells out what we're trying to do. For those amenities which basically depend upon a certain amount of income, we were trying to do at least break them and to operate them. And by the way, these words were very carefully chosen in a business-like manner, not as a business. And the distinction is important because what Terry said, what Jeff said, is true, that they're not purely a business for us. They're much more than a business. I think when you look at something, the question is not so much whether or not the amenity in... whether or not the amenity loses money or not, that's very important. But you also have to understand that, I mean, that problem is not in the amenity itself, but it's in the way that it's managed. And that's the thing that we need to address. And that's what that resolution tried to address. And I would recommend that you look at that and see what it says and see if you agree with it. Because, by the way, you all, with your input, you can change things, resolutions.
Larry?
Amenities are an absolute asset to Ocean Pines. What would Ocean Pines be without them? The pools are great. The pools are absolutely, and the other amenities that we offer people draw people to live, become residents in Ocean. We possibly will lose some money on some of these. But if we take them as a whole, how much money is actually lost? What we consider the good that these amenities do for the community. The community is going to keep growing, folks. 20 years from now, there'll be a lot of younger people sitting in this audience. And your property values will go up because of these amenities. Think of that. My consensus is that we use our money wisely. The amenities are a big plus to Ocean Pines. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next question will begin prepared. If the estimated cost does not exceed 20% of our assessment, which today is in excess of $1.5 million, our bylaws enables our board
undertake capital expenditures for replacement, renovation, or repair of existing facilities and to require new facilities or land to add a referendum. Do you think that this threshold should be maintained as is, or do you think it should be amended to a higher or lower amount?
I think it should just be maintained. When that amount was decided upon, obviously the cost of things have gone up. I wouldn't increase it, but I also wouldn't make a decision on a project based on having the authority to do that for a number that large. We don't need a referendum for a number that large, and that's for that was developed for a reason. I was not there when it was developed, but that guideline was there for a reason. But I certainly would not take a vote and vote on something like that without a long, hard thinking about what was entailed. I would have to ask those people that were experts in whatever the expenditure was for. I'd have to really evaluate what it was for the community. If we weren't going to do something, usually when we do something that's that large, we do town meetings and let people voice their concern. Sometimes we can't. Sometimes things are still in the confidential stage, contracting issues, things like that, that we are really not supposed to make public until we're at the point where we can. That doesn't mean that we do things behind people's backs as people tend to believe. I would leave it the same, with knowing that my responsibility was to make sure that if we had to spend it on something like that I would never do it without all the facts of making sure that people were supportive.
Yep. I would leave it the same. I would also tell you that in looking at projects that are proposed, I personally do not pay attention to whether it is above or below the referendum. I look at it to make sure that the costs are as good an estimate as we can get, that all costs are included. If it's over the limit, you do a referendum. If it's under the limit, you don't have to. You could even do one there if it was appropriate. Just because you don't have to doesn't mean you can't. Referendums don't bother me at all. They are the way that we get input from a very broad section of property owners here. And so I'm not afraid of them at all. And if we decide in the referendum to do something that I had proposed, that's great. If we decide, no, we really don't want to do that, that's fine with me. My ego's not wounded. It's okay. So I think that referendums are fine. I wouldn't change the limit. Things have gotten more expensive. That number you could argue should be larger. I'm not arguing that, but I would leave it the same. Dave?
Yeah, I think the referendum, what are you going to change it to? Up or down, or what's your rationale, and why is that the way it is? And so the number itself is, I think, reasonable. I think it's reasonable even in our time. I was a little surprised at Terry's answer, because in fact, I was in a meeting, and this is public now, it was a closed meeting, to decide to buy property over the Times Shore, maybe you all heard about that. There was a proposal that we buy the place over on the other side of Beecham Road. We authorized, with myself dissenting, the general manager to go right to the referendum thing. And Terry, if I'm not mistaken, he told me, Dave asked me, Dave, if you can't go to the limit, then why should we have one? And at any rate, I described it. But that's the kind of problem that you can have. Now, eventually, that sort of all came out 6 months later after multiple offers were made for the property. That's more like the problem. I mean, the lack of visibility or the necessity to have transparency in when we're spending and why we're spending. That's why referendums that are good things, and they can be good things even if we're below the amount. It's because it takes away the questioning that happens later on afterwards.
That's good.
I think I'd have to experience sitting in a meeting to basically really answer. But I would basically go along with the other members at the front here, the other candidates, and say, be the same. But it'd have to be studied individually. And right now, I don't have the expertise. That's why I'm your independent candidate coming on board. But believe me, it would be carefully spent and carefully thought of before any action taken.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm in agreement with the rest of the board members. I think the referendum limit of 0.2 million seems to be reasonable, unless we have a significant cost of living situation for a little period of time. I think we have to leave it as it is. I think if you drop it too low, then you have a lot of complaints about people who want to have smaller projects. So if you go too high, then you have people that are going to be abusing it, perhaps, to build projects that shouldn't be built. And I also agree with Dave Stevens when he says that referendum, Gary said too, referendums are not a bad thing, no matter what the number is. I think input from the people is very, very important. So right now, I'd leave it as it is, but I would also suggest that we do referendum once again.
Thank you. We'll now proceed to the next question, and Jeff will be the first person to back. The Yacht Club is open in business. Golf Course has cut its losses by almost 40% last year, but the aquatics program, again, lost over $200,000. Would you vote to get rid of the aquatics program to avoid the loss?
No.
Okay.
Slight elaboration. If you look at the net again, as I do, we're okay. The net for the amenities is positive by a small amount. I could pick aquatics to work on. In fact, I think we've just hired a new director of aquatics, has great credentials. She hasn't been here very long, so it's kind of early to make any judgment. But I think we're doing things, and we ought to do what we can to reduce losses in aquatics. But this is an oceanfront community. Okay, water is all around us. It's one of the things we like, except when it rains too much. And so to get rid of aquatics does not resonate with me, and I would not do it. I'd go fix it if I could.
Dave?
Yeah, I think we kind of bit the bullet on aquatics when we covered that pool. I mean, before that, we were making money. After that, we were losing money. We cover a pool. It raises the utility cost very high. We did that, by the way, at just under the referendum, so there was never any gold rush. And by the way, I still think I won't want it. I know, of course you don't get rid of aquatics. Now, I do question the question of numbers as far as golf and the Yacht Club. The Yacht Club particularly, it's TBD. I mean, I've been over there four times. I had dinner there four times, started with a couple. We had enjoyed ourselves every time. It was great. But, you know, until we see what the numbers are, I mean, we're not going to know how that will. Golf, we already know that it's been pretty big. And as I said before earlier, I don't know why, but I do know how to find out.
Yep. That.
Larry?
Oh, I'm sorry. I dropped.
I can't buy you.
Is your karma? No, I would not change the aquatic. It's a key part of oceanfront. Pools, program. There are certain expenses that had to be incurred a few years ago. Whether they were wise to do that, that remains a point of discussion. was done. The aquatics are losing money presently. In a couple of years, I agree with Jeff, we have to basically site our energies a little bit more there, get competent people to operate it and run it, and hopefully it can become even again with regard to expenses. Thank you.
My answer is like Jeff's. No, I don't want to say much more, but I use the membership. I'm there three times a week at least all year long. That's several times. And it's great for my back, my legs, and all other parts of my body that are aching with arthritis. That's a great, great exercise for anybody who has it. And I see a lot of heads there. I would not get rid of aquatics for that very reason. However, I will say this, that if we have to find an alternate method of funding it by, I hate to use the word necessity, but I'll have to use it. I'm paying $370 a year, I believe, for my membership. So if I have to raise that another $30 or something to cover losses, you know, I'd be willing to do it. I think most people with swimming membership would do it also. Thank you.
Eric?
That question gets asked a lot. Should we just close our... I think it's a really great thing to keep asking that question. I think we should ask that question of all of our amenities all of the time. Should we keep it? Should we close it? What should we do? Obviously, our pools are very important to Ocean Pines, utilized by, you know, like Pat said, the older people who swim. We have swim teams. We have swim classes. We do have an aquatics director who we understand is doing a gangbuster job. The aquatics committee, which I was a liaison for as well, works very hard at helping Ocean Pines decide what is the best way to keep our pools current and safe and et cetera, et cetera. They've been looking into energy management in that covered pool for a couple of years. It's going to be addressed probably in this. I believe there was some money in this budget year, but I'm not 100% sure. I know that there's a lot of pool work coming up. But the energy issue in that covered pool is a big issue because it's very expensive and it needs to be addressed. But they have done a ton of research. We need to look into that to decrease the cost. But I actually think the covered pool is a great thing. I think to have a pool open all year long for people who want to go utilize it, and especially for the youth in the area who want to swim and parties and swim team and all that, I think it's a great thing for people in our community. So I would.
Thank you. Now, move to the next question, and Dave will be the first person to respond. Question is, if you are elected, would you consider it to be your responsibility to monitor closely the execution of projects in terms of budget, progress, and on-time completion? If not, please explain your rationale. If so, what steps would you take to assure yourself such projects are on track?
Yes, it is the board's responsibility to do that. And now in terms of how the board does it, I think it has to get direct reporting. I mean, it may use, I mean, certainly all of the members of the board do not have the expertise, maybe none of them do, in terms of construction and some of the complications, or technical complications of the executed project. But the board can insist on regular reports. It can have its own advisors who are monitoring the construction or the execution of the project. It is their absolute responsibility to track it and to track it closely because we are spending more money. And an example, I think, I mean, of that, which is something that was tracked very closely, is the building that we're staying in. It's on the board at the time. Dorico was on the board. Marty Clark was on the board. And, in fact, Lehman was selected as a contractor, and there was a number of board members, plus other people, experts, that were watching every step of that contract, every step. We tracked every dollar that was spent. And this building came in, not much, but ahead of schedule, and not much, but came in under budget. No extras, no anything, under budget, period. And that's what should be done in the future, and that's what a board board member's responsibility is.
Thank you. Larry? With regard to this question, I think that it is...
Microphone.
Mark. I'm sorry. Well, my Lord, I have a point of great epic. The decision is often made by the board. Monitoring has to also be done by the board. Because the board, with regard to these questions that are coming up and issues, is the ultimate responsibility, and the ultimate responsibility that they have are to you, the people. Quite frankly, I think that's the only and the best answer that I can give you. Everything must be held accountable. And that's the part of accountability that I believe in.
Thank you. Pat?
Thank you.
I believe that the board is accountable, probably has been in most of its cases, but I think it's the dynamic between the board and the general manager that makes it work. And I mean by that is that everybody has a fair share of the situation. Larry pointed out, and I agree, we represent you, we represent all the people. The general manager doesn't. He represents the board. He represents what the board's desires and wants are. He carries out. He carries out the procedure. He carries out the program. That's what he's supposed to do. We're not supposed to micromanage him in any way and the way he carries it out. Give him instructions as what we want to have done, and he carries it out. So I think you have to focus on that more if we become elected, and we will try to do that. We'll try to make sure the board plays its role as well as the general manager playing. Thank you.
I have to agree and disagree with what Pat said. If anybody saw the board members during the building of the Yacht Club, you'd know that we were probably all micromanaging. We were down there walking around, checking, driving down on weekends. I think Marty Clark probably spent as much time there as probably the construction manager. And that's with all these projects. I've been fortunate to be part of two large projects, golf greens and the yacht club. And just like Dave said, same thing. We were so invested in the building of this yacht club. I can tell you when I went to brunch there and there was some stuff on the floor, I wanted to clean it up because I felt like it was my building. I stood there on Friday night when that building opened at the door and greeted people. I stood there at the ribbon cutting and greeted people and asked people what their opinion of the building was when they left. I felt so invested in it. So, yeah, we do micromanage, and Bob doesn't always like it, but I'm sorry we do it. Marty is probably the biggest micromanager of us all, but you know what? He brings something really important to the table. When, you know, we're going through this process of these abandoned vehicles and abandoned houses, et cetera, et cetera, and CPI violations. He's like the first one to go look at the property. And, you know, good, because we need somebody to do that. And he's, to me, he's taught me that I really need to make sure that I do that part of my homework as well. So we do micromanage, even though we're really not supposed to, but I try my best to let, and Bob does represent me, not just the operations. He represents you just like we do.
Answer to the question is yes. Okay, a little elaboration. Okay. The board has an absolute duty to supervise the general manager and his staff. Not so much on an ongoing, detailed, day-to-day basis at the task level. But micromanagement is I've seen people do it. It doesn't work well. It is a huge time sink. And it doesn't produce an incrementally better results very often. So I personally don't like micromanaging. It's not my style. I don't do it. I've never done it. Okay, that said, supervision is required. It's in our list of duties. It's in the bylaws. It's in the governing documents that we have. And we need to do that. And if the current level on
provision that needs to get cranked up, always remembering that you don't want to crank it to the point where you're micromanaging. And that line is tricky to find sometimes. But you keep that principle in mind, and then you supervise properly, and you'll get a better result. Dave was talking about the result in the, certainly in the community center. Absolutely stunning. The right level of supervision.
Okay. Our next question. Going back, Larry, start. Is the association has a capital improvement plan that goes up to 10 years in the future. Potential improvements over the next 3 years can total several million dollars, but are likely to involve only board approval, not a member's referendum. What is your role as a director in considering proposed capital improvement projects and the funding future projects?
Very careful. We've got to, again, watch what we're spending. We've got to have total accountability for it, and we must have good planning. And that's a key word that I want to basically maybe leave with you this segment today. The important thing is to plan. Plan. Long range, short range. We're talking a lot of money. We're talking about a situation where we've just spent a great deal of money on the yacht club, on a piece of property that from one end to the other is about the length of a football field. And I'm going from the new pool all the way through to Mumford. Years ago, I used to run 100 yards on a football field. I might add very slowly, especially in those August months back in high school. But the simple fact is that we spent a great deal of money. I believe that term country club, if that's in the future, must be forgotten. We basically are going to have to one of these days realize that we can't support two, a country club plus a yacht club. It should be called a country yacht club. And let's use it year round and make it pay for itself. Be careful with the way the money is going to be spent. Be careful with the way planning on spending that money. Do it for the good of the community. The North Gate to the South.
Thank you. Pat?
On any capital project, you mentioned the 10-year plan, which I thought you're looking at three projects coming. Dave or Jeff, but in each case, I think the board has to look at each project individually to find out how much it costs, what it entails, how long does it take to do it, and how important it is, what the priority is. You know, we've been talking a lot about drainage, water situation, and all those kinds of things, and we still haven't come to a conclusion. We're working towards it. I know. We still haven't come to it. Conclusion where we need to do this. It's not a glamorous project by any means. It's not a yacht club or a country club or a golf course or anything else. But it's very, very important. I think the board needs to take the time, the effort to make it happen, not just say pay lip service to it. That's my opinion. Thank you.
I'd like to see us not just have a 10-year plan. I'd like to see us have a 10, 15, and 20-year plan. I think that the projects, as the 10-year plan is a working document, and while we know some things are really need to be looked at and worked on, as I mentioned before, the IT infrastructure, I would not even begin to think about the future of the country club until the situation with the golf course is decided upon, nor would I ever decide what to do with the country club without a referendum. Because just like the yacht club, we needed the members of Ocean Pines to tell us what to do about the yacht club. I would ask the same thing for the country club. So I'm in favor of having a 10-year plan, but I really like to include a 15 in.
This CIP, the listing of assets and when they need to be repaired and so forth, replaced, is ever so slightly backward. Remember, we talked earlier about one of the things you do up front is you get requirements. And after you know what the requirements are, the needs, the wants, the what can I afford part of the discussion, after you know that, now you can talk sensibly about the assets that it takes to fulfill those needs, wants, whatever. So this is slightly backward. Now, at the same time, there's another need, because I have this stuff. It's getting older. I kind of ought to figure out when to repair it. So CIP has a kind of a dual personality, and I think it was a great start. I don't think it's the end piece that we're lacking so far, at least in my view, is the requirements piece. How is the community going to change over time? What does that mean for things that we want to service our requirements? Okay, this community changes dramatically if all of a sudden it shifts to very young families with lots of children. It's a different community. I'm not saying it's going to do that. I don't know. But if it does, the requirements will have to change, because what we do now and what we provide for our community as it exists, probably not the same thing. And so you have to do it that way. So it's a little backward in that sense. Having said that, it's an okay start. And I do like Terry's view, 10, 15, 20. 20 is real soft, by the way. But it's good to do.
Dave? Yeah, this is, this whole issue is obviously very complicated, so I'm going to skip over something. So I'll agree with Terry that I think it's not unreasonable to plan out 15, 20 years. And, we're basically, your hard information comes in the first 10 years and more in the first five. So that's a good thing. I think I'll skip over what Jeff said, because, I can't say it strongly enough. Requirements are where you start. What do we need? This is an important question. What do we really need? Okay, I'm going to use the country club. I mean, I'm pretty familiar. There is, if you go to your webpage, I'm pretty sure you can still find this one. But it's been embedded in some of the documents that Bob has given us when he started in on this planning process. It's a report. And it's my name on it. This is a stupid report. And it was basically, it's like a two and a half week study of the requirements we had for the yacht, at that time, the yacht club, the country club, and the beach club. In terms of the country club, we had at that time an engineering report, and by the way, that's been updated. We have another engineering report. And they kind of both said the same thing. The country club is a reasonably solid building, but it's gotten older, and it is in bad need of maintenance. I don't know that maintenance has ever been that provided. But fundamentally, I mean, that was a look at the requirements. So what we concluded is that, in fact, we needed probably the best use would be a smaller country club with multiple uses, such as a fitness center, as a compatible use in the upper floor. You could read it. And we had other conclusions about the yacht club before the doctor, but that's okay. Okay, I'll stop.
Thank you. Now, before we go to close the statement, I have a question to ask everyone. This is the first time we, to my knowledge, had this forum on Saturday. Are there any people here, raise your hand, that do not live here? Okay. At this point in time, we'll move to closing comments. Each candidate will have 1 minute to start.
Thank you, Bill. And thank you for coming this morning to listen to the candidates for office who will represent you. A couple of months ago, a person called concerning an interview. They said, "What do you have to say?" And I said, "I believe change is needed, and changes are coming. I hope you basically agree with me to have total accountability of not only members on the board, general manager. By the way, I have a pleasant surprise for you. The word change is appearing for the first time on the ballot box. But you've got to be smart enough to realize that it's spelled L-E-E.
Okay, thanks. I thought it was spelled P-A-T. I think the issues come down very simple. If you want to continue with the way it's going, if you like Jeff and Terry and the way things are running with the current board and how things are going, then you should vote for that. No question about it. However, if you think a change is needed and that we are going in the wrong directions on some areas, I think Dave Stevens and I represent that coalition. I'm not excluding Larry in this necessarily, but we have, Dave and I have worked together, we've talked about some issues, and I think we pretty much have a meeting of the mind, so to speak. So I would ask you to give your vote to me and to give to Dave Stevens. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Eric?
My closing comments are just basically, we're hearing a lot of talk about needing change, and we need to change, and change direction to do this, and a lot of comments about 5-2 vote and the majority rules, et cetera, et cetera. I think consensus is a good thing. I think if somebody has something they want to persuade me during a board meeting, that's why we have a motion, a second, a discussion. If during the discussion I can be persuaded to that person's point of view, but if I'm not, I will stick with whatever my original point of view was. I personally think consensus is a good thing. We're not always going to get 7-0s, but I kind of think 5-2 is good.
Yeah. I'd like to repeat my thank you to all of you for coming this morning. This is an important part of the process. Hopefully you have a better idea of where we are coming from. I think I have, my background and work that I've done and other things, I have some skills I can bring to the table, and I have a point of view, and you'll like that point of view or you won't. I would encourage you not to do single issue voting. This is a complex place, and we're not always going to agree with each other on everything. I would look at the whole picture. So, thanks again. Dave?
Yeah, I think a couple points. We're seeing a lot of the usual suspects out there, and these people show up in a lot of time after time, and I admire you for it. The issue of change, I mean, it's not necessarily in my mind such a traumatic thing. Nor is it simply the issue of getting a 4-3 vote as opposed to the current 5-2 vote. I mean, it's much more complicated than that. And any board that I am on, I want to be inclusive, if that's in at all possible. And I think it will be, as a matter of fact. I think the things we proposed here, we have a lot of agreement on reporting requirements, planning, capital planning, and major operations post-track. I think maybe if we differ, it's the extent to which we believe the board should be involved, the extent of their control over those processes that we may differ.
Thank you. A couple of announcements before we adjourn here. Ballots will be mailed out July 12th. Voting deadline is August 8th. Counting of the ballots occur on August 9th. And the annual meeting of the Board of Directors is August 10th. Results of the election will be announced at that meeting. How about a round of applause for our candidates?